Good afternoon, Southern California. It's 2 o'clock Friday afternoons, time as usual for Sound of the 60s with yours truly, Roger Steffens. And today, something I've waited for years and years and years. When you say the 60s, one of the first names that pops into everyone's mind is Dr. Timothy Leary. He is here with us in the studio, and we're going to start in just a few moments. But first, let us hear the beginning of the original motion picture soundtrack of Turn On, Tune In, Drop Out.
Are you ready, Ralph? Are you ready to die and be reborn? No. No, first, you must be in a state of grace. First, you must examine yourself in this mirror of confession. What do you see there? Your personality, all your goals and your fears, your little ambitions, the chess game of your life. You have to check that, Ralph. You can't take that on the trip with you. And then that other side of you, Ralph, that dark, unconscious, all those animal impulses which you hide and keep down below. All this baggage, too, must be checked. You can't take that on the billion-year voyage to God. Are you ready? And take this chalice, the elixir of life, the ancient cup the Holy Grail, the alchemist's stone of philosophy, the Holy Communion, the key to immortality. Take this and drink.
My guest today is a self-described alien intelligence agent from the future, and a man who, for those of us who lived in the 60s, had a profound influence on many of our lives. And I'm delighted at last to welcome you to KCRW, Dr. Timothy Leary.
Good to be here.
Is acid obsolete?
Oh, what do you mean by obsolete?
Does it have anything to tell people in the 80s? Let's say the new generation.
Well, it's hard to make big generalizations about anything, generations or drugs, because it's all an individual situation. And on the other hand, there are times in history, there are times in generational evolution that a lot of people are going to do the same thing at the same time. That happened in the 60s when the baby boom generation, roughly 80 million young Americans born between the years 46 and 64, were reaching puberty. Hey, that's a good sound effect.
Has nothing to do with you, I don't
and
think.
And the, what is that?
I don't know. It's an emergency broadcast.
There we go.
Got him off.
Well, that's
thrilling. Comes in automatically. An emergency broadcast.
That's celebrating the fall of the Reagan Empire.
Well, that's
folks, you heard it first on this station.
I wanted to get into that with
you. The Nancy and Ronnie show is over. And if you've gone through those years of doubt and depression, as I have, as to how long this could go on, that last buzzer...
That was it.
It was it.
Round two.
I want everyone to leave home right now, forget this broadcast, and go out and start celebrating for the next 24 hours because a new chapter has begun and it's got to be better.
Yeah, I sense a little bit of gloating there.
I am enjoying every second of it.
Me too.
Reagan's caused me an enormous amount of grief, not for myself personally, but for the country and the aspirations of this wonderful nation of ours, and for young people in particular. I think it was a very depressing episode in American history, and I'm full of gloating and glee. Don't be guilty about that. Don't worry about it. They're going to say, oh, you shouldn't be happy because we need an American president. We don't. We don't need a king. We don't need an emperor. We don't need a pope. We don't need a president. So, that, yeah, go, don't be guilty. Go out there and enjoy this weekend dedicated to a new burst of fun and freedom.
Now, for 6 years, we've witnessed the phenomenon of Teflon presidency. Now, why all of a sudden has this exploded in his face? What happened? Did the establishment itself turn against him? How do you read
well,
this current situation?
Well, I think it's too close to really understand what's going on.
Because we don't have all the facts.
It's going to take years for the facts to come out and for people to get enough perspective to see what was going on. Because we've been living through it. It's always hard when you're going over Niagara in a barrel to figure out what's happening. But the seeds of evil and destruction were built into that right from the beginning of secrecy and lies and repression and basic meanness and lack of concern for young people and for women and for third world people, so that the seeds were there. And I'm no big political pundit. I can't, you know, give you a bottom line on it. But you know what, David Crosby wrote that old song, "It's a long time coming, it's a long time until the dawn." It's been a long time, 6 years, and we're going to be enjoying it for a long time to come.
Can we, in fact, look with hope to the future through a political solution of some kind? Is politics the answer?
No, politics, we all felt, I think many of us have felt for years, politics as we know it is finished.
What replaces it?
I can explain this to a 10-year-old, for an 8-year-old child. Partisan politics, Democrats versus Republicans, is absolutely insane. America is it's like an airplane with 200 million plus people on it. And every 4 years, two guys that want to be pilots spend 6 months fighting each other up and down the passenger. And we're just sitting there watching them to see who's going to win. And finally, when it's all over, the meanest, toughest, most coarse dinosaur says, "Hey, I'm not the president." And then he walks into the control room of a plane with absolutely no temperament, no intelligence, no feeling for what the real problem is, to how to get this wonderful country of 200 million people plus from here to there in the next 4 years. So partisan politics is over. It will be replaced by decentralization of power. It will be replaced by televoting. The idea of having a representational government, started 200 years ago when it took 2 weeks to get, say, a big fat guy like Tip O'Neill from Boston by horse to Washington. Or it took 3 weeks, perhaps, to get Senator Helms from North Carolina to Washington. But they don't represent us. We know they represent themselves and their own small cliques. So the notion, I wouldn't, and I'm sure most people listening to this program, would not send Tip O'Neill across the street with $20 to buy a bottle of wine. Would you send Jesse Helms to the library, you know, to get you a book? I wouldn't trust those turkeys. They're nice guys, but they're just dinosaurs. So the notion that we would let them represent us with important issues like war and peace and education and, yeah. So partisan politics, representation of government, the politics of television popularity and so which we've been witnessing is pretty much finished, and I think by 88 and 96, we'll be electing, we'll be voting, televoting through telephones. Everyone's going to have to make up their issues and make up their decision. That means we're going to have to be smarter. We're going to have to pay more attention. We're going to be responsible directly for what we get. And that's going to be a step forward, I think, in our maturity and in our effectiveness as social people.
You said something to the LA Times about 7 or 8 years ago that moved me so much, I actually wrote it on the entrance to my house so that people saw it as soon as they arrived. You talked specifically about Los Angeles and what LA represents. You said it's the place where the migrants and the mutants
and the future mutants
people come, the end point of terrestrial migration.
Oh my God.
Do you still feel that way?
Well, I think that's an obvious geographical, neurogeographical observation that for 4,000 or 5,000 years, the smartest, the fastest, the most adventurous, the most courageous have been moving from east to west. It was India and the Middle East, and then it was Athens, then it was Rome, and then it was Europe, and then it was England, and then it was East Coast, then it was Chicago was the real lynch point of the future about 100 years ago. And now, obviously, it's in the West Coast. This is the frontier, both geographical and intellectual and scientific and technological. Yeah, this is a place to be. Otherwise, why would we be here?
Mm-hmm.
Why would anyone listening to this program, us included, be here if we didn't think it was the place where you can change and grow and make things happen? If there's a better place, tell me. My wife and I and my family, we'll pull up and go, but tell me where. I ain't going back.
You've written that Westerners are Easterners who smartened up.
Well, that's a good point, yeah. That's a lot of things. Don't believe anything I say. I just spin out. I go around giving lectures and talks like this. I'm not sure why. My basic strategy is, of course, TFYQA. Think for yourself, question authority. So I throw out a lot of ideas here, and bumper stickers and T-shirts and...
Mobility is nobility,
yeah,
being one of the bumper
they're
stickers.
We're not writing a Bible here. I'm not going to lay down the 11th and 15th commandments here. These are simply little buzzes or electric ideational shocks to get you thinking. And God, I don't want you to agree with me, but maybe we can keep stimulating each other to think for ourselves.
Are you hopeful right now in what you see in the past 20 years? I mean, when I think of you in 1966 and what you came to stand for, in a lot of people's minds. Not that I blame you for what other people think of you, but you stood to many of us for opening the consciousness, for seeing the world in its multi-dimensional reality as opposed to the mere Life magazine version of things. Does it shock you 20 years after that to see how far we haven't come?
Well, at my age, I don't think in terms of decades anymore. I know that's very popular, and it's good to be thinking of decades. I'm not thinking centuries now, and I call the 20th century the Roaring Twenties, and the 20th century has been the most exciting, interesting century that I can imagine, because it's basically the century of quantum physics, of relativity, of... it was a time when the physicists, who always are ahead of us, told us that material universe was made up of clusters of atoms and quantum bits and probability clouds and so forth. And the art of the 20th century, expressionism, pointillism, surrealism, has all been along that line of dissolving the heavy static representational.
You left out psychedelic art.
And the psychedelic art, the music, of course, starting with jazz. Jazz is all has to do with improvisation and novelty and new probabilities and improbabilities. and the literature of Joyce, and of course then all the modern writers breaking up the word line, breaking up the grammatical stuff, swirling words around.
Who do you read?
I'm obsessed now with a new form of literature. It's called cyberpunk. It's a wonderful word. Cyberpunk, let me define it, refers to the individual using technology, particularly computer screens and TV screens and movie screens, the individual using them for his or her own pleasure or profit or whim, as opposed to institutions or governments or companies or organizations using screens. So any individual who can get access to a screen, of course the computer screen is the obvious place to start, is cyberpunk. So William Gibson has written a book called Neuromancer. It's swept all of the science fiction awards, the Hugo, the Nebula, and the prestigious Philip Dick Award. But it's not science fiction in the sense of Obi-Wan Kenobi and spaceships. It's really scary. It's science fiction the way it's going to be in 5 or 10 years. With the cyberpunk heroes of Gibson are just ordinary people, computer hackers, RNA chip, black market salesmen. They're all kind of street people who are moving through the enormous structures of the information age and the monopolies and the conglomerates and the international, multinationals. Just as bohemians have and beatniks have and poets have and dissidents have all throughout history. But the idea of cyberpunk means that we're no longer intimidated by high technology and computers. We're going to learn how to do it and get control. So there, this guy, Captain Midnight, the wonderful guy that got in the satellite and just burst into everyone's home and said, hey, this ain't no good for the 20 seconds. That freaked them out because an individual is not supposed to do that. Or Captain Crunch, they got those little black boxes and you could dial around. That's cyberpunk. Jobs and Wozniak, who invented they popularized the Apple computer. See, the personal computer is by definition cyberpunk. Any 12-year-old kid can get this, put his or her own ideas on the screen. So that's the essence of cyberpunk. But Jobs and Wozniak were barefoot, long-haired acid heads, and they actually had made a little money with black boxes. See, they were real punks. And now, of course, they're trillionaires, but they're examples of the power of cyberpunk.
What prevents those kinds of people, Doctor, from being co-opted by the system?
Oh, they probably will be, but who cares? Because
the technology is
out there. Yeah, sure. Now there are several million Apple computers and personal computers. The individualization, the humanization of high technology. High technology used as it should be, as an appliance for your own growth and for your own communication. That's, of course, typically West Coast. It's typically American, and it's the hot notion of I call it the Roaring Twenties. Now, cyberpunk, I mentioned the word William Gibson. He's written several other books, Count Zero, and he's got a new book coming out this coming spring called Mona Lisa Overdrive. He's really a hot writer, and with him, they've clustered a lot of similar spirits who are writing books in the same style. Cyberpunk means a marriage of high technology and high art, good writing, good music, because as we know, most of the stuff on computer screens and most of the stuff that you see in a so-called high-tech movie is kind of a cornball. So low life and high-tech is the individual, wonderful catchphrase right now. I think you're going to hear a lot about that. And it's one of those exciting concepts. Every 5 or 10 years, you run across a concept that kind of gels or brings together a lot of stuff. And so that's my literary answer to you. I read cyberpunk.
In your book, The Intelligence Agents, there's a fascinating piece about Jules Verne, and it always amused me how many of the acid freaks I knew in the 60s were also into science fiction. I'm going to quote from your book, Intelligence Agents. Sometimes Jules Verne's prescience could be uncanny, as Frank Borman, the American astronaut, discovered after completing the Apollo 8 moon mission in 1968. In a letter to Jean Jules Verne, the author's grandson, Borman wrote, quote, "It cannot be a mere matter of coincidence. Our space vehicle was launched from Florida, like the spaceship in From the Earth to the Moon. It had the same weight and the same height, and it splashed down in the Pacific a mere 2.5 miles from the point mentioned in the novel. How do you suppose that happened? What was going on there? Were all the synapses shorting out?
Yeah, I think there are. We don't want to get heavy mystical about evolution here, but yes, I think there are certain regularities and rhythms that, if you look at the planet Earth, the Florida Peninsula is a place to send up a spaceship because it's almost surrounded by water. And the Pacific Ocean, obviously, is a place to drop your spaceship back.
Your spent boosters.
Yeah, sure. And yes, I think that there are certain... I'm a genetic determinist. I think that the human brain and the human DNA is pre-coded so that there are circuits of our DNA and circuits of our brain that haven't been awakened yet. And when the right time comes, they will be. I think neural circuits that have to do with telepathy, for example, or brain computer link-up, or the ability of the brain to decode your own DNA. These are possibilities, they're probabilities, and when the time is ready, it's the 100th monkey notion, which is very corny, but still, there's a certain truth to it. When it's backbone time, it backbones, and when it's steamboat time, it steamboats, and when it's time to launch spaceships, you're going to do it pretty much in the obvious way that they've been doing it on planets like ours probably for billions of years.
You familiar with the Seth books by Jane Roberts?
No.
The essence of them. They're channeled books. They're quite extraordinary. And the essence of them is...
It started channeling, didn't it? That was
And she says, literally, you make your own reality, which is basically what you've said in many of your books, too.
Well, that's a standard Buddhist... from Buddha to Werner Erhard.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's... yes, that's quite a spread, isn't it? Tell me about the very first time, Dr. Timothy Leary, you were aware of the existence of LSD. Do you remember back that far?
Well,
even before you took it now, the first time you heard of it.
The first psychedelic experience I had was with mushrooms in August of 1960. And I was totally unprepared. I was a very successful psychologist, but nothing in my teaching. And I was an open-minded guy, too, but nothing had prepared me for the experience that I had with mushrooms. So, does that answer your question?
No. What about acid?
Well, we were using mushrooms in our research at Harvard from 1960 to, well, 61. Psilocybin is actually, it was actually synthesized by Sandoz Laboratory, and we used to get it by the carton. And it's an extremely wonderful, mellow, loving experience. And those of you who have taken mushrooms, I think, can imagine the power and the warmth of these experiences. LSD came along later. Actually, it was Alan Watts, the great Buddhist philosopher, who gave me LSD on Easter Sunday, 1961. That there was not that...
Were you reborn by that experience on Easter Sunday? Good day to take
it. We were getting reborn once a week those days.
Yes. Yeah.
I remember running around outside catching snowflakes as though they were baseballs at Fenway Park, and Alan Ross flopping after me, telling me I should put my shoes on. Is that being reborn?
Yeah, I guess so. Maybe that goes back to one of my
initial... One thing I'm
going
to say about all this, you know, you got to keep a sense of humor about this. We've been through a lot, many changes, and... anytime we start spouting off from one little niche of evolution that we're on, you got to keep a little sense of humor about it because things are changing so quickly that anything you say today is going to look foolish tomorrow. And there's a wonderful healing aspect to that, that I think the sense of humor is a wonderful device which DNA code has given us to help us grow and laugh at ourselves gently and laugh at each other. That's what's happening with Reagan, you know, looking at... That, you know, guys like Ollie North running around and these admirals that are taking the fifth because they're afraid of criminal prosecution. I mean, is that funny? I mean,
first time in the history of the United States Congress that an acting admiral ever took the fifth. Yeah.
I'm laughing here at myself, too, these questions about the profound experiences of LSD and so forth. Frankly, I've often usually tried to make this clear. Psychedelic drugs, I would include marijuana, hashish, and so forth, they basically are funny. They just get you giggling at the relativity, and you get to see another point of view, and they make you see more connections. Of course, you forget what they were, and you can even forget what you're laughing at. That's all right. But basically, life and human nature and the LSD experience and politics, too, to me, has got to be seen with a sense of humor if it's going to, make sense and help you grow.
Are you still angry that LSD is illegal?
Well, no, I've never been in favor of LSD being legal, and I'm certainly not going to be angry about it. Who's the United States regime that's going to tell me what and what is not legal? That the whole concept is a joke. Why should I want to get Tip O'Neill and Senator Helms to somehow tell me that what I do with my own body and my own brain is legal? I mean, that's a joke. I remember, we used to say in the old days that the last person you want to give you LSD or give you a good love, for that matter, is an authorized government scientist with a stamp to prove it. I mean, get out of here, man. we can get along without Johnson, Nixon, Reagan.
How many trips have you taken in your life? Do you have any idea?
I don't know.
Ballpark.
It's like saying how many times I've made love. Not enough.
Not enough. But not enough. All right, now that's the crux of what I'm going to
ask you.
Oh, I got you
there.
Not enough.
By the way, I'm signing this book to Hank.
Hank, yes.
Yeah, okay.
We have some early books from your career that Hank Holmes dug out of his archives. There's no such thing as too much, then. In other words, despite the fact that many...
Oh, sure there is too much.
Oh, is there?
Oh, my gosh, yeah.
Well,
I'm glad
you mentioned
that, Roger.
Well, good.
All right. I'm very much interested in cyberpunk computing and all that right now, but I will talk about drugs. We can talk about anything. I have used and still use every drug in the book, at least every year. Just out of a Catholic has Easter duty. I try to use every single drug out there at least once a year. And I've used probably more drugs than, there are not many people around at 66, my age, that have used as many drugs for as long a time as I have.
Or look as good as you do at 66.
And the reason for that is I do it with prudence and intelligence and caution and aesthetic sensitivity, and I don't want any surprises, yeah, but I want safety nets. So if you're going to live a life of courage and a life of exploration, you got to have those safety nets. You just can't go blasting off and charging out there without a lot of connections and support systems going so that,
Why did you find it necessary in the 60s, in many of your manuals and, in fact, in the records that we have here today, to take people on their trip into the death experience?
Well, that was... when we started this so-called psychedelic experience research, we didn't know anything about it. There's nothing in Western literature, psychological literature, that prepared us. So being sensible, open-minded scientists, we said, where is the literature here? We went back to Buddhism, our first scientific manual, how to use this LSD, or how to have a psychedelic experience, or how to have a mystical experience, is based on the Tibetan Book of the Dead, because these guys have been doing it, and we change it to the dying. And then we studied the other traditional literatures of mysticism, Gnosticism, Sufism, Christian mysticism, on and on, Kabbalism, and often they use the concept of death and rebirth in the sense of the winter and the spring and so forth. So we use that for maybe 6 months. You must realize that I've been experimenting with the drugs for 26 years, so we've run out of metaphors. We use a metaphor, it works for 6 months, and then you keep changing it so that we have not used the concept of dying for at least 20 years. Another thing about it, you'll notice that record you played, the first few years you were studying consciousness and psychedelic drugs, we were so innocent and sincere, we were using the religious metaphor all the time. Like I was in that record 20 years ago saying...
Talking about the chalice.
God.
Yeah.
Yeah, and the chalice and all that.
Not unlike the Rastas with marijuana.
The reason we did that was a comforting thing. This was also new and strange and bewildering. Hey, if we said, you're going to go into a part of your brain where there ain't nothing material and there's nothing that has anything to do with the 20th century, and you're out there confronting 4.5 years of neurological evolution. So we tried to make it comforting. We used the metaphors of a God experience or of a death-rebirth experience or of the chalice and the philosopher's stone, deliberately using the poetry and the ritual language of the past to give people a link a chain of significance back there, so that we'd reminded this is something, not something new, that the most thoughtful and influential human beings for thousands of years have been doing this, granted that the methods get more precise and the metaphors change. So that's why today I would no more use the word God than I would use the word, you know.
Would you accept a term like all that is instead of God?
I'm not here to accept or reject.
Are you religious? In the traditional sense, doctor? There must be some sense of awe at all that you've encountered.
Absolutely. I'm definitely awed.
Not odd, but awed.
I'm awed, awful, and awed. we run out of awes.
Well, let's take a little awesome break here and hear another track from that original Mercury album, which is funny. I mean, there's a main...
You are now about to begin the great adventure, the journey out of your mind. You will travel far beyond familiar reality into the level of transcendent awareness. You will leave behind you your ego, your beloved personality, which will be returned to you at the end of this voyage. The goal of this trip is ecstasy, to move outside the boundaries of normal perception and consciousness into the far reaches of your nervous system. As you begin this journey, it is important to remember the following basic trusts and beliefs. You must be ready to accept the possibility that there is an infinite range of awarenesses for which we now have no words, that awareness can expand beyond the range of your ego, yourself, your familiar identity, beyond everything you have learned, beyond your notions of space and time, beyond the differences which usually separate people from each other and from the world around them. You must remember that throughout human history, millions have made this voyage. A few, whom we call mystics, saints, or Buddhas, have made this experience endure and have communicated it to their fellow men. You must remember, too, that the experience is safe. At the very worst, you will end up the same person who entered this experience. All of the dangers which you have feared are unnecessary productions of your own mind. Whether you experience heaven or hell, remember that it is your mind which creates them. Avoid grasping the one or fleeing the other. You must maintain faith and trust in the potentiality of your own nervous system and the billion-year-old life process. With your ego left behind you, your brain can't go wrong. Try to keep the memory of a revered teacher or a trusted friend whose name can serve as guide and protection. trust your divinity, trust your brain, trust your traveling companions. Whenever in doubt, turn off your mind, relax, float downstream. In order for your consciousness to flow beyond the confines of the normal body ego, it is necessary to undo the bonds which chain you to the external world, to dissolve the imprints your neurological camera has been carrying around. In other words, it is necessary to eliminate 5 major obstacles to a peaceful dying of the ego: anxiety, desire, anger, doubt, and inertia. Eliminate anxious restlessness. Avoid unnecessary moving and talking. Instead, maintain a calm, relaxed awareness, keeping your body, your feelings, and your intellect still, like a quiet pool of water. Eliminate all selfish wishes or desires. There is no room for wants or needs in the state of ego transcendence. Instead, adopt an attitude of joyous acceptance of anything that might occur, an affirmation of the energy process which will sweep you along. Eliminate any anger or ill will or irritation that you may feel towards anyone, because this will prevent letting go and tend to produce a negative experience. Instead, meditate on love and trust towards everyone, especially your traveling companions on this cosmic journey. Eliminate doubt and suspicious skepticism. A negative attitude will hold you back. Instead, meditate with serene confidence on the unimagined potentials of your nervous system, and try to make contact with the basic life source that is within you. Finally, eliminate inertia and laziness. Maintain a state of calm alertness, ready at any moment to move your attention from one focus to another, ready to recognize the stages of the experience as you pass in and out of them. There are 3 main stages in this voyage. The first and most profound is called the experience of the clear light or the void. Here, you merge completely with a basic energy process. There are no thoughts, no images, no hallucinations, no pleasure or fear, no I to experience. The drop of water is merged in the ocean. There is energy, light, flow, the network of process. You are gone. All boundaries dissolved. The second and longest phase is called the period of hallucination, of game visions and revelations. A part of your ego has reasserted itself, and a multitude of sounds, images, thoughts are created and dissipated at fantastic speed. Both heaven and hell, paradise or torture, may be experienced. Both come from you. The third phase is that of re-entry, or rebirth, or re-imprinting, where your ego strives to return to the body, to rebuild its familiar, everyday reality. As you reach unimagined levels of awareness, try to remember these three phases and try to recognize where you are. Do not attempt to control or rationalize the experience. Let it flow and enjoy the process. You will be returning soon enough. All too soon. There is plenty of time for figuring it all out later. Turn your attention to your body. Try to become conscious of every cell in your body. Notice how various unusual sensations are pulsating through your limbs. The flow of the energy process may cause your body to tremble, or to feel hot, or cold, or to feel pressure in your head. Just as a spaceship passes through the Earth's atmosphere and is subjected to unusual pressures before it can fly freely through space, so your consciousness, in separating from the physical frame of reference, may cause you to experience various unusual bodily sensations. These are the landmarks of the transition points of consciousness. They are no cause for alarm. Actually, they can be enjoyed with delight and pleasure.
Become one with the trembling and the warm pulsing. Use it to get out of yourself. Die consciously. There are many ways in which ego death may be experienced. You may dissolve like liquid, or melt like wax, or shatter like broken glass. Or fragment like a mosaic, or be pulled to pieces, or disintegrate into vibrations of pure energy. Let happen whatever happens. Don't struggle or try to control. Accept. Enjoy. Merge. Exalt. Glorify. 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 Coming back. You are now making the return voyage. You are returning to the world of familiar things. This is a crucial period. The things you see and the people around you may still seem different to you. Do not try to rush your re-entry. During the next few hours, imprints will be formed, which will determine how you will see things in the days to come. Be quiet and careful. Be aware of the photographs you are taking now with your neurological camera. Do not expose yourself to distraction. You may feel that you have supernormal powers, telepathy, or clairvoyance. Do not make the mistake of thinking that these powers are yours through merit. They are merely the natural signs that you are in the re-entry phase. Recognize where you are. A Zen master said, "My greatest miracle is that when I feel hungry, I eat, and when I feel thirsty, I drink." As your spaceship re-enters the atmosphere of the planet, pay attention to where you are landing. This is a unique moment of free choice. The chess pieces which comprise your personality can be arranged in many different ways. You may yourself, as an artist, develop the games of your life and lend it animation. You may complicate it or enrich it as you please. An endless multiplicity in the games of life. That is just what life is when it is beautiful and happy. A game. One can also do all kinds of other things with it. Make a duty of it, or a battleground, or a prison. But that does not make it any prettier. As you re-enter, it is important to remember the effect of your own attitude. Choose consciously. Be aware of where you are going as you return to routine life. Be impartial. Do not re-enter into your old robot out of fear. Do not rush back with desire or craving. Be detached. Choose your new self freely, consciously. You have 5 centers of conscious functioning. The thinking center will make its own new imprint. Your feeling center will make its own new imprint. Your moving center will make its own new imprint. Your sexual center will make its new imprint. Your instinctual center will make its new imprint. The imprints you are now making will govern much of your life in the days to come. The imprints you are now making of other people will remain strong in the days to come. Don't rush. Don't grab. Don't hold on to any one pattern of thought or feeling.
Two monks were walking near a brook. They met a girl unable to cross. The first monk picked the girl up and carried her over. They continued their walk in silence. That evening, the second monk finally turned to his companion and burst out, "You know, we are forbidden to even look at women, far less touch one. Why did you do that?" The first monk replied, "I set her down 3 hours ago. Are you still carrying her?" Try to remain high as long as possible. If you have started to come down already, try to regain the transcendence of the earlier, most intense period. This will ensure a smooth, gradual re-entry. This is a precious opportunity for gaining insight and understanding. Do not waste it by rushing back to to your familiar world out of desire or fear. In order to prevent or postpone the return, meditate as follows. Think of your protective figure or guide as like the reflection of the moon in water, apparent yet non-existent, like illusion produced by magic. With this in mind, contemplate the figure tranquilly. Then let the visualized form melt away, starting at the extremities. Meditate without thinking upon the void, clear light.
If you have not found liberation in this session, there is still time. Meditate as follows. The visions and hallucinations which you are now having indeed all phenomena are in their nature illusions. However reality may appear to you, in truth it is unreal. Dreams, apparitions, non-permanent, non-fixed. Do not be attached or afraid of the products of your own mind. If you take these illusory forms for reality, you will wander around in this confused existence. They are like dreams. Echoes, cities of clouds, mirages, mirrored forms, not real even for one moment. Hold one pointedly to that train of thought and the belief that your visions are real will be dissipated. The world will glow for you, and liberation attained.
A man dreamed he was a butterfly. He woke up. He said, "Now, I do not know whether I am a man who dreams he is a butterfly, or a butterfly who dreams he is a man."
Sometime during this period, your spaceship may encounter turbulence as it re-enters the atmosphere of the Earth. You may feel confused and bewildered. You may wonder about your sanity. You may look at your fellow voyagers and friends and sense that they cannot understand you. You may think, "I am dead. What shall I do?" And feel great misery, like a fish out of water. You may wonder if you will ever regain your normal self. Familiar places, relatives, people known to you appear now as in a dream, or through a glass darkly. If you are having such experiences, thinking will be of no avail. So do not struggle to explain. This experience is the natural result of your own mental program. Such feelings are signs that you are in the third or return phase of the session. Trust your guide. Trust your companions. Trust the natural flow of the process. Recognize calmly, without distraction. A man traveling across a field encountered a tiger. He fled, the tiger after him. Coming to a precipice, he caught hold of the root of a wild vine and swung himself down over the edge. The tiger sniffed at him from above. Trembling, the man looked down to where, far below, another tiger was waiting to eat him. Only the vine sustained him. Two mice, one white, one black, little by little, started to gnaw away the vine. The man saw a luscious strawberry near him. Grasping the vine with one hand, he plucked the strawberry with the other. How sweet it tasted!
As you return from your psychedelic session, you see spread out before you the world, your former life, a planet full of fascinating possibilities, objects, and events. Each aspect of this return voyage can be a delightful discovery. Soon you will be returning to take your place in worldly affairs. The key to re-entry is this. Take it easy, slowly, naturally. Enjoy every second. Don't rush. Don't be attached to your old game. Recognize that you are in the re-entry period. Everything you see and touch can glow with radiance. Each moment, a joyous discovery. Thank you.